Today's topic is on Weidner's views on development administration. The objectives of the topic are the emergence of development administration, features of development administration, models of development administration. The term development administration was first coined by UN Goswami, an Indian scholar. He used this term in his article entitled The Structure of Development Administration in India, published in the year 1955. However, it is George Gant, an American scholar, who is regarded as the father of development administration. He too started using the term development administration in the year 1955. His book, Development Administration, Concepts, Goals and Methods, was first published in 1979. Edward W. Weidner is the foremost proponent of development administration and also the first to conceptually explain the definition of development administration. Emergence of the term development administration. Development administration emerged as a subfield of public administration in 1950s and 1960s. The factors contributed to this area are, number one, overemphasis on the study of means of administration, and number two, underemphasis on the study of goals of administration by the traditional public administration. Number three, emergence of newly independent developing countries like Asia, Africa, and Latin America due to the liquidation of colonialism and imperialism. Number four, United Nations sponsored development schemes in the developing countries through multilateral technical aid and financial assistance. Number five, setting up of Comparative Administration Group CAG in the year 1960 under the protection of American Society of Public Administration. Number six, search for a new indigenous administrative model to meet the developmental needs of the developing countries due to the failure of Western models in these countries. Definition of development administration by George Gant. Development administration is that aspect of public administration in which focus of attention is on organizing and administering public agencies in such a way as to stimulate and facilitate defined programs of social and economic progress. He further observed, development administration is characterized by its purposes like socio-economic progress, its loyalties, accountable to the people, its attitudes, persuasive and motivative approach. Meaning of development administration. According to Edward Weidner, development administration is the process of guiding an organization towards the achievement of progressive and social objectives that are authoritatively determined in one manner or the other. Edward Weidner, 1921 to 2007. Edward Weidner was an educator, public administration scholar, and founder of the University of Wisconsin-Green Bay Weidner Center. Edward Weidner is the foremost advocate of development administration for the post-colonial third world countries. He wrote many books and several articles on development administration. His important works are, number one, Development Administration, A New Focus for Research, 1962. Technical Assistance in Public Administration Overseas, The Case for Development Administration, 1964. Development Administration in Asia, 1970. The Elements of Development Administration, 1970. Contribution of Edward Weidner. Edward Weidner criticized the traditional administrative theory for its overemphasis on the means of administering in the best possible manner and underemphasis on the study of goals. In this context, he commented, public administration has glorified the means and forgotten the ends. Good administration and good human relations have become ends in themselves, quite apart from the achievement of other values that they may or may not facilitate. According to Weidner, development administration is concerned with Maximizing Innovation for Development. He defines innovation for development as the process of planned or intent change in the direction of modernity or nation building and socio-economic change. Features of development administration. Number one, change orientation. From stratified to egalitarian society, from an agrarian economy to industrial one, from totalitarian political regime to democratic, from particularism to universalism. Number two, goal orientation. Social development, ensuring equality and justice. Economic development, ensuring growth in production and consumption. Political development, ensuring national integrity and nation building. Client orientation, focusing on rendering better services to clients and target groups. Time orientation, timely completion of development projects. Commitment orientation, participation orientation, ensures people's participation and making people stakeholders in the development process. People's participation is ensured by means of local governments, voluntary organizations, pressure groups, legislations, etc. It prevents the possibility of corruption and promises transparency. Weidner's 8 models. These works have made Weidner a distinguished pioneer in the field of development administration. His research articles have gained much popularity with the students of development administration. We shall briefly analyze Weidner's most important ideas on development administration. This consists of 8 models. Number one, the ideal planned directional growth with system change, Weidner in the year 1970. Weidner viewed this model from an idealistic point where development is visualized as a continuous process. The plans are formulated for growth in the direction of modernity, nation building and socio-economic progress. To realize this growth, programs are worked up and implemented with system change. Differentiation and coordination are brought about to ensure goal accomplishment. In this context, most of the less developed countries have set up planning commissions which reflect the view of development process. It has been felt that this ideal set of conditions of planning system, change and growth does not often evidence itself. This is mainly due to, number one, the ability of any political and administrative system to go in for directional growth and system. Change is severely restricted. Number two, the ability of an administrative system to carry out a planned program of major change is often severely limited. Further, Weidner explains that successful innovation in an administrative setting is not easily accomplished. All the countries of Southeast Asia have formulated 5-year plans, and the majority of these plans have been a complete failure in practice. The prominent reason for this failure is an inadequate administrative system. Number two, the short-term payoff planned directional growth with no system change. In this model, the less developed countries which face difficulty in introducing major system changes have made many leaders of their countries explore the possibility of maximizing development within the limitations of the present system. Weidner held the view that the positive attraction to this strategy is it having maximum payoff in the short run in terms of consumption or nation building and socio-economic progress. Weidner has found 4 circumstances in which this model is adopted. Number one, where the leadership of a country is not revolutionary and represents a balancing of forces and short-range results are appealing. Number two, if there is little technical assistance or foreign aid, or if such assistance is obtainable without major strings attached, planned directional growth with no system change is attractive. Number three, where the country's leadership is experiencing political trouble, but there is a desire of stabilization. Number four, in countries where there is a demand to show results or an emphasis on consumption, the short-term payoff is frequently followed. Planned development growth within the limitations of present system does not mean that the amount of differentiation cannot be increased in any way. The level of coordination can't be raised, but it is a matter of degree. This provides leaders with a tremendous range of possibilities. This can be made possible through the creation of in-service training unit in the personnel agency of the government, subdividing an existing bureau by adding additional units to a branch of an agency, which could enhance the authority of its chief. Third model, the long-run payoff, planned system change with no directional growth. In this model, Weidner in the year 1970 says that there will be a planned system change with no directional growth. Growth is the direction of modernity, nation building and socio-economic progress, which is a common short-run occurrence and may also occur over relatively long periods. According to Weidner, system change does not necessarily result in growth. It may have an adverse effect on growth. He gives an example of land reforms that resulted in lower agriculture production. Weidner feels that political and administrative systems are objects of values. He uses Esman's classification of regimes such as conservative oligarchies, competitive interested oriented party systems, dominant mass party system, authoritarian military reform regimes, communist totalitarian regimes as political systems that vary widely in regard to differentiation and coordination. According to Isman, each system has distinctive consequences or implications for administration, and each has its vigorous champions, individuals and groups who highly value the system. The system is the system's pattern, is differentiation and coordination. Fourth model, failure, planning with no growth or system change. In this model, Weidner in the year 1970 discusses planning with no growth or system change. In 1965, a group of Asian and American economists came to a conclusion that development planning had not been successful. The reasons cited were economic growth had not been accelerated and apparent growth was barely adequate to cover population increase and inflation. Weidner gives an excellent illustration of a budget reform to prove that it is difficult in determining failure in regard to growth with or without major system change. According to the budget reform in Vietnam in the year 1950s, the budget function was removed from the Ministry of Finance and Foreign Aid from the Ministry of Public Works. In place of these ministries, a central budget agency was established and a highly innovative director recruited from the civil services. An important step he took was not to fire or demote existing employees. He conducted a massive retraining program and assigned them with new duties. As a result, the employees were highly motivated and gradually the entire operation became more streamlined, giving the president a comprehensive expenditure balance each month a few days after the accounting period ended. The training program was extended for budget officers of the ministries and agencies of the government. Up to this point, the director, with occasional assistance from one or two foreign advisors, had made extensive changes in the budget procedure by largely using existing personnel. These changes were accomplished within a year. Coming to the second aspect of this illustration, Weidner's observation is that the limitation of the output increases without major system change extended to an agency, which gets evident through subsequent events. When the concept of program control and program budgeting was introduced to other ministries and agencies in the government, there was stiff opposition. If these concepts were to be carried out, there would have been a major shift in the decision-making framework of the government. This would have resulted in a substantial change in the role of the budget agency, the presidency, the finance ministry, and the others. Ultimately, the director was removed because carrying out about changes involved major changes in the government. On the basis of the above illustration, Weidner has brought to the fore certain changes. positions as listed below. Changes within an agency headed by an innovator that involve major system changes tend to create resistance because the major changes have implications for those outside the agency. Any proposed major change in the administrative system of agencies external to that of an innovator will encounter extremely heavy resistance. Innovation, short of government-wide change, will be inhibited to the extent that central controls are present. Fifth model of Weidner's views on development administration, environmental stimulus, unplanned directional growth with system change. This model stipulates that by deliberate act, we can bring differentiation, coordination, and growth. Modernity, nation building, and socio-economic progress involving major differentiation and coordination can take place in an unplanned manner also. The process of planning on large scale involves several steps. Number one, goals to be determined. Number two, priorities to be established. Number three, program of action to be identified. Number four, implementation devices to be put in place. Number five, putting control into effect. According to Weidner, there are several things that make planning in this manner unlikely or at least very difficult. First of all, a strong nationwide push for developmental change is the most difficult to carry out in practice. Weidner stresses that while some planned change can take place from the center, determined and able leadership, the most extensive innovations are likely to be product of the individual minister. Bureaus, provinces or districts and the autonomous pilot projects. Weidner feels that many of the changes that emanate from society come by reaction of leaders or groups to certain environmental factors. As per Weidner, emulation is another force for change that may have an essentially unplanned character. Foreign or domestic models relating to programs, agencies and procedures may be emulated on a wide scale. Emulation will be a strong force for change where communications and transportation is good, so that opportunities for simulation from other models are readily available. Pragmatism, unplanned directional growth with no system change. In this model, a little change in differentiation and coordination in line with a decentralized initiative, completion, adoption and emulation can bring about growth in the direction of modernity. According to this model, it is relatively painless. It produces some short-run payoffs and does not require complicated planning mechanisms. In countries where poverty, disease and social isolation have not been addressed, but there is a limited desire to adjust to the changing world, the most natural and attractive course to follow is unplanned growth in a development direction with no system change. It is an important supplement to an extensive program of planned change. In this model, unplanned change largely comes as a result of decentralized initiatives, adaptations, and emulation related to the particular nature of the crisis may lead to a major system change. Continuous or extended crisis will lead to planned as well as unplanned adjustment. Static society, no plans, no change. Few societies are totally static and there are parts of societies that approach a static state. There are also pockets of change and pockets of resistance to change in developing countries. Weidner states that in spite of favorable circumstances for change, a certain amount of driftlessness occurs in nations. In this model, crisis may not lead or bring forth a desired change but be viewed fatalistically by a planned or unplanned manner. The review of the models. By analyzing Weidner's models, the conditions under which change takes place are many and varied. Emphasis on production and consumption lead to three major strategies of the formal planning process. A similar group of three strategies also exist for unplanned change. In addition to these six sets of conditions, depending on strategies and tactical choices, According to Weidner, these schemes can be applied to an administrative system. A member of the task elite or a policy concerned administrator. They provide for greater variations in the conditions in existence from one period to another and from one part of the administrative system to another. It is also possible that several sets of conditions will form part to some degree or another in any large agency or government. Basically, the decisions depend upon the balance or mix of the six models with some kind of payoff. Normally, there is no standard prescription for or description of developmental change. In development administration, two important aspects are planning and system change. They are potentially producers, and their most effective combination leads to modernization. Planning and system change are important, but not the exclusive aspects of the development mix of a government or agency. An administrative agency devoted to modernity, nation building, and socio-economic progress is expected to consider how to encourage developmental change under each of the six sets of conditions leading to change. According to Weidner, lack of devotion by the administrative agencies results in short-sighted planning. Full-scale planning fades into a less vigorous type that eventually leads to a lack of planning or perhaps just maintains an environment for change. Major system change fades into minor system change, leading to an overall lack of system change. Keeping all the above in mind, it would be a likely hypothesis that in their efforts to achieve development goals and outputs, public agencies prefer to encourage unplanned change and planned change that avoids major alterations to or within the system. It is difficult to state in which model a developing country would fit. Some feature of a developing country may be appropriate to one model, while other features belong to another. These models are useful to identify the developmental direction of a country. Some scholars have observed that it is difficult to define goals for development action. Goal identification is never simple and in complex. Developmental change situations, it can be very elusive and difficult. Lack of clarity on important aspects of goal orientation causes confusion about the true nature of development administration.